Hello and welcome back to my channel. For today's mountaineering video, we're going to be doing another movie review. In November, Netflix released a movie called The Summit of the Gods, and I asked if y'all wanted a review about it, and you said yes, and spoiler alert, this movie blew my freaking mind. It was not at all what I expected it to be. I have so many feelings about this movie. Now, when I was originally planning on doing this movie review, my plan was to give kind of a basic idea of what the movie was about, not really give you any spoilers, and then tell you my review. But that plan has changed. See, this movie was not at all what I thought that it was about. Like, not even a little bit. Like, I had like 0.001% of the information that I needed about what this movie was about from the synopsis that was given on Netflix. I thought this was a movie that was just gonna try to answer the question about whether or not George Mallory was the first person to successfully summit Everest. I thought it was gonna be an interesting little bit of conjecture, because nobody actually knows. I thought there might be some fun little, you know, it was fiction. It was just gonna be a movie. That's not what this movie is about. This movie tries to answer the question of why mountaineers climb. Why do climbers do what they do? What is this drive? And y'all, it is intense. It's so good. It's so intense. It's so not what I thought it was. And there are some distressing elements in this movie that I honestly wish I had known about before I watched it, because it was like, the fuck is happening right now? So here's the thing, because of the way that this movie was done and because of everything that they put into it and because it ended up being so much deeper than I anticipated, I can't give a proper review of this movie without talking about everything that happened in it and without talking about the upsetting elements, because it was so important. And so my recommendations for you watching this video is, if you don't want spoilers for the movie, go watch the movie first. I will warn you that the most like distressing element in the movie is suicide. Somebody commits suicide. That's really upsetting, obviously. So be warned about that. There's also some flashing imagery in one of the scenes toward the end, if that's something that you're sensitive to. There are other things, but I think that those are the two big things that you need to be warned about if you're gonna go into this with no knowledge. Other than that, if that's something that you can handle, absolutely watch the movie. Otherwise, I'm about to delve into this entire storyline and then I'll give you my review afterward, because I can't unentangle these things. This is so, this might be the longest video I ever make. This is intense. Oh, the other thing that's important to know is that if you're somebody who needs subtitles, like I do, I have auditory processing issues, I always use subtitles. The subtitles in this movie are not accurate if you are watching it in English. It's originally a French film. I'm not gonna try to pronounce it in French because I'm not trying to embarrass myself today. In English, the subtitles are like a completely different script. I don't know if it's translation issues. I don't know, like, if it's that the English movie is literally completely different than the French movie. I don't know. So my recommendation if you need subtitles would be to either watch it in French with the subtitles or watch it in English with the sound turned all the way off, because they're more hurtful than helpful, to be honest. I had to watch this movie several times without the subtitles and try to get all the information. And to be honest with you, the only reason I recognized a lot of the things in the movie was because I'm already familiar with mountaineering. Otherwise, I would have had no clue what they were saying. So from the synopsis, I thought this was going to be about trying to figure out whether or not George Mallory was the first person who ever summited Everest. In true mountaineering history, in 1924, he and Andrew Irving were trying to be the first people to ever summit it. They went missing near the summit. Nobody ever knew whether or not they had summited. In 1999, Conrad Anker and his team found George Mallory's body, but they still weren't able to answer the questions based on what they found. So this is a true mountaineering mystery. And it's what I was interested in this movie, but the synopsis just said that an obsessed photojournalist tries to find the answer of whether or not George Mallory summited Everest. You know, he finds his camera. And so I just thought it was going to be fiction. I just thought it was going to be kind of an alternate universe. Like, what if when we found George Mallory's body, we found his cap? So I was like, this is weird, but okay, I'm into it. Whatever. We're going to try it. What this movie was about. This movie starts with an animation of Mallory and Irving climbing up Everest in the 1920s, and there's a narration by one of the main characters of the movie, basically who this movie revolves around, Fukumaji Makoto. He's a journalist and he's wanting to know why. What is the climbing for? Why do we climb? We cut to seeing him climbing on Everest himself with a Japanese team trying to summit on the Southwest Face years ago and see that they didn't summit. And he's really frustrated because he didn't get any photos of the summit. Nobody summited. He saw that as a completely pointless climb. After the climb, he's making phone calls talking about his frustration, and a man approaches him and tries to sell him what he claims is George Mallory's camera. But Fukumaji's not interested. He's like, get out of here. As he leaves the bar, he sees that man getting mugged for the camera and he tries to intervene. When he tries to intervene, he recognizes the mugger, and you see this moment of just absolute shock on his face, and time just slows for a moment, and then he's not able to successfully follow. Fukumaji gets home and he starts narrating what happened to George Mallory and Andrew Irving. This takes place in the 90s, and in this timeline, in this movie, George Mallory's body has never been found. They do show animations of Mallory's body on the mountain, and it was eerie how much it was. I mean, it makes sense, but it was eerie. It was just exactly like the photos of George Mallory's body when he was found. If you see the photos or the video of that, the animation that they did was dead on. Maybe that's a poor choice of wording. It was extremely accurate. So obviously, Fukumaji's big question is, did they summit? He's obsessing over this. We cut to him in his office, and he's looking for somebody named Habu Joji. We figure out that this is the mugger from the alley, and that he's a climber who's been missing for about 8 years, and nobody knows where he is. Habu is an infamous climber, and Fukumaji is now suspecting that Habu actually found George Mallory's body and found that camera himself, and he wants to know what's on it, and he wants to know how Habu found it. So he talks to his bosses, and he gets permission to start looking for Habu as an assignment. He thinks that he can really make a big story if he finds this camera. We start getting some kind of climbing montages going between Habu climbing and Fukumaji looking for him. And that's something that's really happens continually through this movie, is time jumps and seeing things happening concurrently. It's really beautiful the way that they animate it. It might sound a little bit confusing when I'm describing it. I'm trying to do it the best I can, but it's really beautiful the way that they managed it in the movie. So we're learning about some of Habu's accomplishments as a climber as we're watching this montage of him climbing in the past. And we can tell that this is him in the past because he still has all of his fingers. When Fukumaji saw him in the alley, he was missing two of his fingers, and that was the big recognition factor that he had. So through this montage, as we're learning about his past, we cut to a scene of Habu in the past with his climbing club. Habu is asking his friend Inoue to come on a climb with him the next day, and as they're having this conversation, the president of the climbing club comes and lets them know that they got the sponsorship for their Annapurna climb. However, he says that not everybody is going to be able to afford it, and it's clear that Habu and Inoue do not have the money to go on this climb, and that they're going to be left out of it because of that. Now, this is a real source of contention in the climbing world, especially on the tallest mountain in the world, because there's been an issue with people who have the money to afford these climbs, but don't have the skill to do these climbs, going on these climbs and then dying. It's a huge issue, and they put other people at risk. I believe it was 2019, actually, they finally actually instated that you have to have climbed, I believe, two other 8,000 meter mountains before you can climb Everest now. So it's little things like this, like the movie is very much integrated with the real climbing world. I was very impressed with all of the just little things in this that it's like, this is like real, you know? So anyway, he's really mad that he's a really talented climber, but he's not getting sponsored because he's not rich. And so he decides that he wants to do something really, really daring so that he can get big and get sponsorships and he can do these climbs and people will pay for him to do these climbs. And he asks Inoue to go with him to do the demon wall. And Inoue clearly just is like, I don't want to do that. Despite that, we cut to this freaking beautiful scene of them climbing the demon wall with Habu leading. And oh my gosh, I seriously can't get over how beautiful the animation and the music in this movie are. I don't have words. I don't have the words. The words don't exist. It's so beautiful. Beautiful doesn't describe it enough. I wish I had a better vocabulary. You should probably be watching videos from somebody other than a high school dropout if you want a better vocabulary for this. But it's beautiful! Anyway, they successfully summit the demon wall, and you see a picture of them on the summit on a climbing magazine, and then we cut to Fukumaji holding that climbing magazine. And this is one of the really beautiful things in this movie, is the way that they do a lot of these time jumps will be, you will witness what happened, and then you see the newspaper article or the magazine or whatever, and you cut to the person presently holding that and reading about it. And it's just like, the way that they flowed the time in this movie is incredible. They did it in a really beautiful way. I usually get extremely confused in movies that have different, like, time jumps and stuff like that, if it's not clearly like, this is this day, this is this day, my brain can't keep up. But this movie did it beautifully. So Fukumaji's holding this magazine. We learn that he's traced Habu back to Nepal 8 years ago, but that's the most recent he's able to get to. We go back to the past and we see everybody after the Annapurna climb, and we learn that nobody actually successfully summited, and they're all thanking Habu for saving their climbing club's reputation by doing the demon wall. But they start telling him that it's just down to luck and everything like that, and he gets really heated and he starts defending his skill. He also gets too into himself and is like, well, I was leading, so I basically did that climb by myself. And you see him throw Inoue under the bus as his partner. And this is a theme. At the table, there's this younger kid who is just absolutely, like, taking everything in that everyone's saying, and you can tell that he thinks that he is just sitting amongst gods right now. We cut to Habu and one of the men sitting at the bar as this conversation continues. Habu had to walk away or was maybe told, hey, you need to step away for a minute because you're too heated about this. And this man he's sitting with is telling him that this kid, Bentaro, is completely obsessed with him, thinks he is just God's gift to man, and would really, really love to climb with him. Habu absolutely flat out refuses, says, the kid is too young and I'm not climbing with him. As this is going on, we hear that at the table, there's a discussion going on about what you would do in a really high intensity situation. The question was, if you're tied to somebody who is injured or unconscious and is like dragging you down while you're climbing, do you cut the rope to save yourself, or do you try to also save them and likely you both die? And you can see that everyone at the table is really struggling with this question, and they're like, I couldn't just leave somebody behind. Habu jumps in and he says, I would cut the rope. There's no sense in both of us dying. And they're like, but Habu, what if you were on the other end of the rope? And he was like, then cut me. There's no sense in both of us dying. Literally just let me die. You can see that he's got a very detached attitude about this, and he's very no nonsense. He's like, there's no emotion for him. A climber named Hase Suneo follows Habu outside and introduces himself. Habu recognizes him because he just recently set a new speed record. Hase congratulates Habu on doing the demon wall and asks how he did it, and you cut to this montage of him explaining his route. You can tell he's just loving this. So much time is passing and he is just loving getting to get into the beta for this climb. After he finishes giving him the beta, he finds out that Hase is planning on doing the demon wall solo the next day, and he does it successfully. He makes the news as a climber to watch, and he is now making it big. We cut to present day Fukumaji interviewing someone who appears to be Inoue. He says he stopped climbing with Habu because he realized that Habu did not care at all about his partners, and he only used them as a means to get higher up. And he did not want to live in his shadow, and not many people would climb with him after Inoue stopped. We cut back to the past. Habu's getting ready to leave for a climb, and that kid from the bar, Bentaro, comes running up to him and is begging to go with him, telling him all about his preparation, all about what a good climber he is. He can really do this. Habu's like, no, you're too young. It's too dangerous. Absolutely not. Go home. The kid says, if you don't take me with you, I'm going by myself. And we can see Habu really struggling with this because he knows that this kid is going to die if he goes by himself, so he can't let him do that. So he reluctantly allows the kid to come on the climb with him. We get this long, beautiful climbing montage. I mean, I seriously cannot overstate how beautiful this movie is. You see Bentaro learning all kinds of new techniques. You see him gaining confidence. You see him figuring things out. You see tense moments that they get through. It's beautiful. And then comes a point in the climb where Bentaro slips and he falls, and he is hanging on the rope, and they had just done an overhang, and so where Bentaro was hanging at, there was no wall anywhere near him. He was just over open air, and he was hurt, and so he's freaking out. He's calling, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Habu's trying to figure out what to do. You see him slipping, so he gets himself anchored to the wall better so that they can hold up, and he starts trying to pull the rope up to pull Bentaro up. But as he's trying to pull this rope, you see that the rope is fraying, and if he continues, the rope would cut. My heart was in my throat for this entire scene, and this, for me, was definitely the most upsetting scene in the movie. So you see Habu and Bentaro trying to figure out solutions, and then Bentaro just passes out. He's passed out, and he's just hanging over there. And you see Habu really trying to figure out what to do. You see a lot of time passing, and now it's getting dark, sun is going down, and they're still hanging on the wall, and Habu does not know what to do. Bentaro wakes up, and he starts calling up apologies again, and Habu's telling him, don't worry about it, I got you, we're gonna figure this out, we're gonna go climbing in the Alps together, because the kid had said, you know, maybe we can go climbing in the Alps someday. He was making him all these promises, and as he's doing this, Bentaro reaches into his pocket and pulls out a knife and cuts himself loose. I've watched this movie so many times, I didn't think I was actually gonna tear up talking about it, but it was an upsetting scene. It was upsetting. They didn't show, like, him, you know, they didn't show anything awful, but he committed suicide. You see his body bag being taken away later. You see his sister talking to the paramedics, and you see Habu being taken away in an ambulance. And this was the point in the movie where I was like, what the fuck is this movie about? What does this have to do with George Mallory? What, like, I didn't, like, at this point, I hated this movie. I was like, what is actually going on right now? What the hell is the point of this? So we now see Habu struggling with depression. He's struggling with drinking. We see him send off an envelope of money. And then we cut to current day, where Fukumaji is talking to Bintaro's sister. She's saying that even though there was never a name on the envelopes, she knew exactly who it was coming from. Habu sent her money for years. She doesn't blame Habu for Bintaro's death. She says that, you know, you can't stop people from doing what they're going to do. Bintaro had it so strongly in his head that he was going to do that, that he would have gone on his own if Habu hadn't taken him, and that she couldn't blame Habu for that. And you really kind of get a little bit of closure in that scene. So she says the last letter that she got from Habu was from 3 years ago in Nepal, but she doesn't have an address for him or anything like that. That's just the end of the line. So we cut to past Habu driving through the mountains as Fukumaji is narrating what the Alps climbing records were back in the day, which was to climb any of the great faces of the Eiger, the Matterhorn, or the Grand Strasses solo in winter. Habu and Hase Soneo both were trying to be the first climber to climb all three of the great faces for the first time alone in winter, and we once again get this absolutely beautiful climbing montage. So Habu had successfully climbed two of the three mountains ahead of Hase, and on the third one, as he was climbing, he slipped and fell. You see him get caught on his anchors, and he is hanging from his rope alone, and he is hanging eerily in the same way that Bintaro once did. So he's passed out for a while, and when he wakes up, his entire left side is in pain and unusable. You see him start to drag his way up to a safe ledge using one arm, one leg, and his teeth. It's a difficult scene, but it's also, like, some of the stories that I've heard, some of the things that I've read about the things that people have accomplished to save themselves in the mountains, it evokes that, like, how does a human do that? So Habu eventually gets to this ledge where he spends 3 days and nights freezing. He is really miserable. You can see him suffering from delirium. He's getting frostbite. And there's a point where he is being haunted by the memory of Bintaro, who is just taunting him and talking to him. And it is horrifying. You see a moment where you actually kind of wonder if he's dead, and you see that two of his fingers are completely frostbitten, and you learn that that's where he lost those two fingers. So finally a helicopter comes in to save him, and we not only learn that it was Hase's team who spotted him and sent for his rescue, but also that Hase had completed all three of those climbs and had taken that record. So Habu recovers, he's now working in a climbing shop, and he's still sending money to Bentaro's sister. We cut to current day, and Fukumaji's reading an article all about Hase Suneo's death on Mount Everest. He now believes that Habu is trying to accomplish something that nobody has ever done and climb the southwest face of Everest alone in winter. He called around Kathmandu and found out that Habu had applied for a climbing permit on Everest 3 years ago that had been denied. He says the only reason it would be denied is if he was trying to do something particularly dangerous, like climbing the southwest face alone in winter. He's getting more obsessed with finding Habu and finding the answers now, not only about George Mallory's camera, but about what the hell Habu is up to. He gets a call from Bentaro's sister, who realized that the last envelope that Habu had ever sent had come from a different location than the others. It came from Namche Bazaar, which is the last place that you stop at on your trek into Mount Everest. So we cut to a montage of past Habu packing up his entire apartment and current Fukumaji packing up a gigantic bag, and they both fly to Nepal. Fukumaji arrives in Nepal, and once again, we get an absolutely beautiful montage of his trek to Namche Bazaar. Again, it's just like, the animators did a beautiful job of looking at actual reference photos and then drawing exactly those. It's so beautiful. They did such a good job. They did so I need a better word than beautiful. Gorgeous-malicious! That feels like a weird word to use for animation, but it's gorgeous-malicious. So he arrives at Namche Bazaar, and he's directed to this secluded house outside of town. He goes and he's looking through the windows and trying to see if Habu's in there when Habu pops up behind him and tells him to get lost. Fukumaji says that he knows he has George Mallory's camera, and he also knows that he's trying to attempt the southwest face of Everest alone that winter. He says that Habu is going to need evidence of his climb. He's going to need photographs so that people know what he accomplished. Habu denies knowing anything about anything and tells him to get the hell out of there. Fukumaji calls through the door to him and tells him that no matter what, he's gonna be at base camp that winter taking pictures of him and that Habu can't stop him. We cut to Everest that winter, and Fukumaji is at base camp alone. He's pondering about climbing, and he's talking about how mountaineering, the whole point of mountaineering is to climb the highest. And you would think that once you've done that, it would be over, or that once your rival is dead, it would be over. Like, why are you still climbing? What is there to accomplish when you've already accomplished really incredible feats? But he says he realizes mountaineering doesn't work like that. A mountaineer is always finding new challenges. He starts going into some of the real life history of the climbing of Everest, and he's talking about all these things when we see Habu arrive at base camp with his porter. There's a tense moment while Habu glares at him, and then he throws him some tent poles as if to say, help us set up. We see them inside the tent that night talking about what the weather conditions are going to be like, and Habu says, you know how this climb is going to go. This is a solo climb. That means I do not help you, you do not help me. I don't care what conditions I get in, I don't care how bad it is, you don't help me, and I don't care what kind of trouble you get into, I'm not helping you. This is a solo climb, don't interfere. His porter also says to Fukumaji, you need to watch out for yourself. Do not try to push yourself to where his limits are. If you feel like you need to turn back, turn back. He also warns about the migraines and other physical symptoms that will come once they hit 7,500 meters. Before the climb, Fukumaji is trying to talk to Habu, and he's asking, why are you still doing this if your competition is dead? Why are you still doing this? Like, he doesn't understand what the heart of mountaineering is. And Habu says that once you get a taste of it, there's no going back. Fukumaji also tries to ask him about George Mallory's camera again, but Habu just walks away. So here's where we get into the climb, and this is absolutely beautiful. It's absolutely unrealistically beautiful. They did such a good job animating this climb. The music is absolutely beautiful, and you really see Fukumaji starting to figure things out for himself. They are coming up against all kinds of obstacles, and most of the time it's focused on Fukumaji making this climb, seeing, how am I going to do that thing that he just did? How am I going to do this? How am I going to do this? And it also evokes similar feelings as when you saw Bentaro figuring things out and figuring out how to do climbs and stuff, figuring out how to climb with Habu. Habu had asked Fukumaji why he was here. He said there has to be a deeper reason than just photos. And as you're going through and seeing these obstacles that he's overcoming, you're seeing him go, what am I doing this for? You can really, like, wordlessly, you can see his mindset changing, and it's a really incredible thing. So the second day of the climb, the porter radios that a storm is on its way. The plan is to climb as high as they can, as fast as they can, to try to get above the storm. You see Fukumaji start getting hit with migraine pain, but he doesn't turn around like he was advised to. So he's climbing up this wall as this storm with over 200 mile an hour winds is coming towards him and starts hitting him. You see him being overtaken with migraine pain, and honestly, while this wasn't the most like emotionally intense scene, this is my least favorite scene in the entire movie because it was just really intense. His entire body was flashing red with pain. There was a lot of flashing imagery. There was this intense dark black thunderstorm rolling in. And so it was just a lot of black and red flashing imagery and you watching him freezing up, and it's like panic inducing for him. So as you're watching this and you're just convinced that he's gonna die, you start hearing the sounds dully of an ice axe thudding through snow, and then you see Habu's face pop up and he slaps him awake and he's like, come on, we gotta go, we gotta go. Habu's trying to save him, and Fukumaji's like, leave me, you gotta go, just leave me, you're gonna die too. And Habu would not take no for an answer. You see him strap Fukumaji to his back and climb up to safety, and it's a really intensely moving scene. So Fukumaji wakes up in Habu's tent, and there's rock fall all around them. They're on this really small exposed ledge, and it's clearly really dangerous. Fukumaji is apologizing, saying that, you know, because of my fuck up, now you've completely lost your chance to summit. Habu saying that the only way that they'd be able to summit is if they went on the yellow band, which is way too exposed and way too dangerous in winter, and so the climb is over. Fukumaji wants to know why Habu turned back for him, but Habu refuses to answer. The next morning, Habu tells Fukumaji to be safe getting back down to base camp. It's clear that he's intending on continuing up, even though it's not safe for him to do so. We see Fukumaji climbing back down to base camp as Habu continues to climb up through the returning storm. We see him reach the summit ridge and he has no oxygen. He's struggling, he's shaking, he falls, he has to pick himself up by his ice axe. He is just shuffling one footstep at a time toward the summit until he finally gets there and just falls to his knees looking at these mountains around him. We see Fukumaji stumble back into base camp and be greeted by the porter. He's barely made it, and he learns that the last radio contact from Habu was the previous day when he'd been planning to tackle the summit. He hadn't been heard from since. Fukumaji was in really, really bad shape and he needed to be taken care of. So we go between seeing the summit from base camp and looking through binoculars to scenes of Fukumaji just sleeping and recovering and resting and having his hands bandaged. At some point during this, they realize that something is wrong and Habu might be stranded on the mountain. At this moment, I thought they were going to ruin this entire movie. It's not that I wanted Habu to die, but It would have been so unbelievably unrealistic for Fukumaji to make his way all the way back up and save Habu. That would have just taken the realism out of this entirely. Just, I really thought that they were going to ruin this entire thing. I know that this movie is dark, and it's not that I want to make mountaineering and climbing sound like this dark, awful thing, because it's really not. But it wouldn't have happened in real life. It wouldn't have happened. High mountain rescues are a very, very hard thing to do, and they rarely happen on 8,000ers. And so the idea of somebody who already wasn't a super experienced climber going up and single-handedly rescuing Habu, it just wouldn't have been realistic. I had a moment where I was like, please don't ruin this. I really thought they were going to send him back up there, but they didn't. So we see the porter packing up base camp, and he says that it's time to go. And Fukumaji's like, we got to wait one more day. And he's like, there's no point. Habu's gone. We got to go. They don't know whether he reached the summit. The world will never know that he reached the summit. We, the viewers, know that he reached the summit, but nobody else will ever know. So as they're leaving, the porter hands Fukumaji a package, and it is George Mallory's camera wrapped in a note. His entire ending speech is a freaking tearjerker. It is so good. I will never be able to do it justice. Not ever, not ever, not ever. I really think that you need to just hear it for yourself. But Habu said that he stopped questioning why he was climbing when he realized it was something that he could not live without. So we return to the summit, and we see that Habu has died on his descent. But the way his body is positioned, nobody who ever comes across him will be able to know whether he was ascending or descending, just like George Mallory. So we return to the city, and we see Fukumaji looking really unhappy with his day-to-day routine. He gets George Mallory's camera developed, and we see his reaction to whatever is on the camera, but we never see what's on the camera. They didn't try to answer the question of whether or not George Mallory summited the mountain, which is beautiful. I love that they didn't try to answer that. Fukumaji gives his own little ending speech about why people climb and why he himself climbs. We see him climbing Everest again, and the camera is panning over as he's getting near the summit. I am going to quote what he said here because I think it just wrapped everything up so perfectly. He says, "Now I know that there doesn't need to be a reason. For some, the mountains aren't a goal, but a path, and the summit is just a step. Once you're there, all that's left is to keep going." Ooh, sorry. So he's climbing towards the summit as the music swells and the camera cuts out, and we also don't see him summiting. And oh, y'all, I have feelings about this movie. I should not have worn makeup for this video. Sorry for the sudden change. This is next day dev, editing dev. I was editing this video and I realized that the entire actual like review portion of this was just me crying and not making sense because I had so many emotions about this movie. So we're gonna try to do this in a little bit more of a cohesive manner. Essentially, I thought that this movie was really, really beautiful. I was absolutely blown away by everything in it, from the animation to the music, to the way that they cut the storyline together and showed you the time jumps, to the way that they had, I mean, the tragedy that happened with Bentaro continually came up in the movie and really showed you how it drove Habu to do better. I really loved that he was somebody who seemed very callous and very much about himself. And then when it came to the hard moments, he was there to help people. I think it really shows that sometimes you don't know what you're going to do in those situations. You might even think that you're somebody who's just going to cut and run and save yourself, but you don't actually know what you're going to do until you're in those situations. It's hard to put into words, but I feel like they couldn't have done this movie in any other way. I really don't think that they could have. I know that maybe, like, you could argue that they could have used somebody other than a child to commit suicide to demonstrate that pain that happens in these losses. But it's like I said before, all of the hardships in this movie, I feel like, really added to this is why we do this. And I think that having Bentaro be who he was, it added a layer of pain to it. It added a layer of incredulity. It added a layer of, this is horrifying. How can you keep going? How do you move through that? And it shows that when climbing is what you're about, you don't have a choice. There are so many people, so many mountaineers, so many rock climbers who have been through such unbelievable, unspeakable tragedy. There have been children who've lost their parents, parents who've lost their children, and they continue to climb. And people don't understand why. They can't fathom why you would risk your life for this. They can't fathom why, especially if you go through loss after loss after loss, especially when you're suffering, why you would keep doing this. And I don't think that they could have done this movie in any other way. I don't think you're fully gonna understand it unless you watch the movie. I understand that it may be too triggering for some, and that's why I wanted to do this full review, because I understand that there's a lot of upsetting elements in it. But I think it puts it in perspective. Climbing is not about tragedy, don't get me wrong. The whole point of climbing is to get there and back, to quote Jimmy Chin's new book that I just got for Christmas. So many other climbers that I admire and respect and follow and who have been my personal heroes, it's their philosophy to reach the summit and get back home. And if they can't reach the summit, then their only goal is to get back home. You know, climbing is supposed to be as safe as possible. Climbing is supposed to be about community and about pushing yourself and about survival. But there is tragedy in it. There is hardship in it. It's a very dangerous sport, and that's a part of it. And I know that people who are not a part of the climbing world really struggle to understand why people would want to do this. And I think that this movie answers those questions, and I don't think it could have done it in any other way. I love that they didn't try to answer the question of George Mallory. And I love that they did the same thing with Habu. It's not that I wanted Habu to die. It's not that I want anyone to die. It's not that I want people to go unrecognized. But the way that they did this, they just made it so clear that it's so much more than the summit. It's so much more than the recognition. It's so much more than any of that. Honestly, I think that if I were to rate this movie on a scale of 1 to 10, my biggest complaint would be the subtitle issue. If the subtitles were accurate in English, it would be a 10 out of 10. You can still watch it in French. It's a great film in French. I want to understand what the differences are in, like, why are the words so different? I would like to have accurate English subtitles in English, and I don't speak French. I'm assuming that they're accurate for the French, but I'd like accurate subtitles for both. That's my only complaint about this movie. That gets it to a 9.5 out of 10, just the subtitle issue. I think that the biggest takeaway from this is that climbing is so personal. It matters more to the individual, to the climber, than it does to anybody else. Climbing is about survival at its core. It's you versus you. It's you versus nature. It's you seeing what you can withstand. Nims Dai has talked about how when you're climbing in these mountains and you are in that level of suffering, because every mountaineer I follow says that it's not fun. It's not fun. When you're on these mountains, you're going, why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? I hate my life. I'm suffering. Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? And then as soon as they're done, it's like, oh my God, I can't wait to do my next climb. There's a term for it. There's like tiers of like levels of fun. And there's like fun that you know is fun in the moment. And then there's like fun that you're not having fun in the moment that is fun later. Or there's like fun that you're having in the moment, but then later you're disappointed. I don't remember. There's a whole scale for it, but this is like top tier suffering. And then later you're like, oh, that was pretty awesome. And anyway, Nims, as well as other mountaineers, have talked about you'd get into this like almost meditative state because it's just about surviving. You are just in these extremes and nothing else matters. The entire rest of the world melts away. And yes, it's about community and it's about who you're climbing with and it's about so many things, but ultimately it's you and what can you do? What can you accomplish? What can you survive? What are you capable of? And that matters so much more than any outside recognition. That inner recognition, that inner validation, that knowledge of self matters more than anything. I think this movie was beautiful. I know that there are going to be people who disagree. I know that there are going to be people who think that it was just unnecessarily tragic, but I don't think they could have done this movie any other way. I think that this movie is something that everybody should watch who's able to. I understand that it could be very, very triggering for a lot of people, and I'm not trying to say go push past your triggers and go watch something upsetting. But I think if it's something that you think you can watch, it's something everybody should watch. I think it's so beautiful. I think it's so moving. And I think it really gets to the core of why people do what they do, why mountaineers do what they do. It was so human. It was so raw. It was so painful. It was so real. And I don't think they could have done it any other way. I know they've said that like 10 times now, but I was astounded. I was blown away. When I went into this movie thinking it was just going to be about speculating on whether or not George Mallory ever summited, I never anticipated all of this. I never anticipated them to go into the depths that they did. This is a movie I'm gonna watch hundreds of times. I can tell you for sure. Absolutely. I have definitely not watched enough. 9.5 out of 10 just because of the subtitle issue. I absolutely recommend. I think if you really want to understand mountaineering, that this is a beautiful film to watch. But I also think that if you really want to understand mountaineering, you should get involved with real mountaineers. There are so many mountaineers who are on Instagram. Even there are mountaineers on social media posting about what they do. That's where I followed the 14-7 Project Possible that Nims died in 2019. That's where I followed everything and saw all the updates. You can follow climbers as they are on their climbs, and they'll be updating live from their climbs and talking about what they're going through. It's pretty incredible. There are also a lot of really wonderful climbing documentaries out there. Actually, side note, I will say Habu being an incredible climber who is missing two fingers did make me think of Tommy Caldwell. Tommy Caldwell is one of my absolute favorite climbers in the world, and he is missing part of one of his, I believe it's his ring finger, his middle finger or his ring finger. And he is, there are several different documentaries that he's in, but The Dawn Wall is a really beautiful one. It goes over his climb with Kevin Jorgensen, climbing the Dawn Wall on El Capitan. And it's freaking amazing. And it also shows you how he learned new climbing techniques after losing that finger. People thought that his climbing career was over, and it was not. He just ended up being an even better climber, and it was amazing, and it was so cool. And so that just made me geek out a little bit, because I was like, oh, Tommy Caldwell, even though he was evidently not based on Tommy Caldwell. But here's just my little extra nudge to tell you, go look into Tommy Caldwell and watch Dawn Wall, because that's also a really good movie. So yeah, this movie definitely goes down in my top three favorites ever list. And I definitely recommend that if you've gotten this far and you're interested, you should absolutely watch it. It's a really good movie. Thank you for watching this video. I really hope that it was enlightening. I hope that it entices you to go watch the movie. Even if you learn the whole synopsis of the storyline, I hope that you actually go watch the movie, because it's so beautiful. They did such an amazing job. They really did such an amazing job. I want to thank all of my patrons for supporting this work. I want to thank you so much for making it possible for me to do these videos. If you would like to support my Patreon and get access to all of my videos early, as well as other behind the scenes personal content, consider signing up for my Patreon. I have it linked down below. I also have some very exciting special projects coming up this year that are going to be going on Patreon, but I can't talk about that yet. But I'm very excited. I'm extremely excited. I'm very excited. Let me know what you thought of this. Let me know if you did see the movie, what you thought of it. Let me know if you're gonna watch the movie. If you go watch the movie after watching this video, come back and tell me what you thought. I would love to hear your thoughts. I would also like to know if you would like more of these types of reviews in the future. If you are interested in more of this type of content, let me know. If you're not, that's totally cool. I hope you find more content that resonates with what you're looking for. I think my sign off at this point is to not have a sign off. So...